Cindy, the name of that one, some senior discount right here on the Tony Jones Show. Before that, you heard from The Butchers, Man, Man, the name of that one, facebook.com/Tony Jones Show, on Twitter at Tony Jones NRI. Be sure to check out rifreeradio.org. Chuck from the aforementioned senior discount in studio with me.
Hey.
And that song is very special to me because, and well, we just in case any of the censors out there are listening, no, you did not hear the F word.
No, not at
in
all.
That track.
No,
right?
No. My girlfriend Gina, who's sitting here, swears that in some version of that song, where I say "drop her and do it again and again," the first word is an F bomb, and it is not. It was never recorded that way or written that way.
Now, Tony Jones and the Cretan Three have a song called "Cindy Was a Terrorist." And that has to do
this
with...
This is a prequel song.
Well, that has to do with a bandmate of mine, who shall remain nameless for legal reasons, I guess, just had an awful wife named Cindy, and she literally terrorized this poor man. And out of that came the song, Cindy Was a Terrorist.
Could have easily been the same Cindy.
Maybe, I mean, maybe it's linked to the name.
It is. I think so.
You know, maybe all Cindys are nasty, vile women.
Our Cindy is the Back to the Future 2 version to your Cindy the Terrorist.
So we talked about it a little earlier, but kind of go back the 11 years, and you know, maybe someone's listening to the show, they're hearing about Senior Discount for the first time. Mm-hmm. Kind of bring us through the timeline of how you guys became, you know, became a band and became kind of a well-respected, you know, regional band.
Well, I think basically what happened was I was in high school with my cousin Christian and my buddy Kevin Silva. And I think that during that time, we were all into music, and I think during that time, I became aware of a local scene by the band Sea Monkey Stew, and this is like 2001 or 2, I found out about them at like the Fall River Battleship Cove Festival or something. Definitely wasn't like an actual like Providence scene thing, and because of that, I started going to shows in Providence. I met and became a fan of the band Monty's Fan Club at the time, and around 2002, we said, you know what? Let's be a band. But we didn't play any instruments. That was the only problem at that time. So I said, I guess we're going to learn instruments. And we basically like took songs that Kevin had written, because he had already he actually had played bass. But we took songs that he had written, and we kind of just practiced 5 days a week all summer long and kind of for the next 2 years. That's when we started playing in 2004. And that was the beginning of the band, the beginning of our exposure to the local scene. And Monty's Fan Club was actually kind of the helping hand to us. When the first big show we got was 2004 in June. And the way that we learned how to promote and do all that stuff was that Monty's Fan Club had a house in Narragansett. And we came over their house and they're like, we're going to get you guys on the show. Here's this many pre-sale tickets. Here's, by the way, if you want to talk about the pre-sale ticket
we could do a whole show on that.
Yeah, I know. Here's all these flyers. Here's this. Here's this big list of businesses that are going to put up flyers. Here's the shows we can promote at. And they really taught us that whole method of really promoting hard. And that kind of, we thought that was the standard, honestly, back then.
And that's kind of, you know, we talked earlier about kind of taking younger bands and kind of bringing them under our wings. I mean, there's so many people that have done that back in the day, if you will, for any band coming up. And it's always great to pay that forward.
Exactly. Yeah, absolutely. And I think that we kind of, they had such a great work ethic that it rubbed off on us. We thought, like I said, we thought it was a standard. And we did that so much that we kind of, I think we raised a lot of eyebrows really quick. And because we also weren't just a band, we did a lot of short film stuff to promote our shows. And this is honestly, it sounds so awful, but pre-YouTube. I think, like, seriously, we did our first video in June of 2004. And I think that YouTube really hit in late 2005. So we had these videos that we'd host on our own server, on our website. It would crash all the time because people were coming.
I remember uploading my first podcast in, you know, maybe the late 2000s, and it was brutal. I mean, it was an all-day event to get that content online. And then anybody, you know, trying to access it through dial-up internet also just really had to be committed because it was an all-day event.
Exactly. And I think that one of the reasons that we got a little bit more exposure when we came out for the first couple of years was because of our videos and the stuff that we did with that. And especially because it wasn't just like comedy videos. We did stuff that was a little bit more stunty. Like we would do like stunts and pranks. And, you know, for one Halloween, we filled our guitarist room with 300 pumpkins. And for the following Thanksgiving, like a month later, he came home and there was a live turkey running around his room.
Now, you know, that exact same stuff is getting YouTube content creators millions of dollars these days.
I know. You know
back
what?
Then it probably cost you money to do.
You want
to
know when I monetized our YouTube channel? Last week, we have 55,000 views, and I'm like, oh, okay. So we did all that stuff, and I think that it helped us out in terms of, you know, making people laugh. It's weird because music can be, is it divisive or derisive? It can divide people's interest. Like basically, if you're like, hey, I'm Chuck. I'm from a punk band. They could be like, boo, I don't like punk bands.
Yeah.
And turn you off. And like, people are like that. I'm not like that. And I think that most people around the music scene aren't really like that. But fans and people that go to shows definitely are. And comedy is a little bit more unifying. So putting up those videos and displaying our personalities, I think it really helped people open up to the idea of supporting us and wanting to come to shows. And we also just kind of mercilessly asked for shows we wanted to get on. We got a lot of them, and you know, we worked really hard to get people there, so we were able to rise up pretty quick, and it was great. It was really helpful. I think that our focus on not just music is probably what helped us a little bit. I think,
you know, and the interesting part is that the people that are divisive are usually the most vocal. You know, it's not the people that go to a show to check out every band that are going to be, you know, I saw a great band tonight. It's going to be the people that
people
I don't know, they're just miserable and they have nothing else to do, I guess, is what it comes
People are
to.
Happy to be negative, and it's very, very upsetting. I've, you know, honestly, doing the podcast has really, I was never that guy, but it made me even more careful about not being that guy, where I'm like, you know, a lot of the stuff I say is recorded now. I've been doing a podcast for 6 years. We're on episode 2, like 20 this week, I think. And I'm like, I got to be careful with what I say. And if I'm going to criticize something, I want it to be constructive. I want it to be hopeful. And I want it to be a positive criticism where things could have been better. Not this person sucks. This project sucks. This band sucks. That's never going to come out of my mouth. It is. It's. I think the people that like that, I think there's an element of, there's an enjoyment behind getting people mad. that I think that they like, especially when you're putting your opinion out in public. That's part of it. And you know what? Don't get me wrong. I think that getting people mad can be funny, but I want to do it with like a turkey in your room, not making fun of your life's work. It's a different thing.
That's what's the kids today call trolling.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah,
I kind of had, you know, a similar situation when I ran for public office. Is that when I decided to run for public office, I had to take a look at, you know, all these videos of me getting hit in the head with steel chairs and bleeding all over the place and, you know, getting thrown off roofs and stuff like that. Well, you know, I mean, if there is any momentum, this is the first thing that's and, you know, I mean, younger kids face that today, as you know, we didn't really necessarily, unless we were into media at the time, where all these kids kind of getting naked and running around. Well, that video is going to probably surface in 10 years.
I know. That's right. We talked about last time about you coming on my podcast and us doing a whole wrestling episode of us talking about
hours on that.
I know. I'd love to do a backyard wrestling episode because I grew up doing the same stuff previous to the band. My stuff was more comedy based, though. We did a little bit of stuff that's questionable in terms of safety, but I'd love to hear about your experiences. It'd be so funny.
So we're going to get back to some local music. I want to get more into the podcast in just a little bit.
Sure.
And we're going to, of course, as we always do, let the ladies have their say here on the Tony Jones Show. So the next three tunes you hear will be all great female-fronted rock and roll from right here in Little Rhodey, kicking off with Roz Raskin and the Rice Cakes. Here's Floorboards right here on the Tony Jones Show.
If I can't get out, wanna see front of me, eyes open.